With this, we would like to move on to academic session. In the first program, I would like to welcome Dr. S. Murugan, Professor HOD, Department of Dermatology, Sri Ramachandra Medical College Hospital. He has got a rich experience of 18 years of teaching experience with 15 years of postgraduate teaching, more than 20 publications in indexed national journals. He has got a numerous awards, scientific presentations. He has become the chairperson in the Asian Dermatology Congress and Dermacon and World Congress of Dermatology and Hair India Congress. He has got a unique and special interest in pediatric dermatology, trichology, teledermatology, cosmetic dermatology. At present, there is only one field which procure, which harvest more money than any specialty. This is a dermatology. You just, without touching, without any undue stress, you can earn a lot. You can put all the money into single, I mean, locker and keep it for your lifetime. Over to Dr. Murugan, sir.
Thank you, sir. At the outset, I would like to thank the prestigious IMA Kodambakkam branch for having invited me for this occasion. Respected president, respected secretary, respected vice president, academic coordinators, thank you one and all. So I would like to move on to the topic now. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, I will start the screen share.
Go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. Go on.
Yeah. Okay. You take your own time. No issues.
Is it visible, sir?
No, not visible, sir. Screen share earlier. iPad la irkingla computer?
Computer la sir. 1 minute.
Ella window close pannittu.
Yes, sir.
Zoom and slide show mattum vechukonga.
Okay, sir.
So, try the slide share again. Vandhichingala?
1 minute.
Slide show vittu matha ellam close pannunga sir.
Yes, sir.
ஆனா ஸ்லைட் ஷோ ஓபன்ல இருக்கணும். ஓபன்ல இருந்தா தான் நீங்க ஸ்கிரீன் ஷேர் பண்ண உடனே அது கிளிக் ஆகும்.
ஸ்லைட் ஷோ ஓபன்ல இருக்கு சார்.
நான் இப்போ ஸ்கிரீன் ஷேர் ட்ரை பண்ணி பாருங்க.
There is a green button in the below sir. Share screen.
Go on.
Sometimes the zoom window la odi padum and the mouse kida kondu paninga na automatically appear avum sir.
Oh, visible la iruka sir?
Illenga. Ah, ipo vandirchi.
அதெச்சினா
சார் எஸ் சார் ஐ வில் ஜஸ்ட் கோ டு ஸ்லைட் ஷோ மோட் போங்க அதுலயே ஸ்லைட் ஷோ மோட்னு வரும் பாருங்க உங்களுடைய விண்டோலயே கீழ லாஸ்ட் 3 பட்டன்ஸ்ல கீழ வாங்க மவுஸ் கீழ கொண்டு வாங்க
கீழ வந்துட்ட சார் இப்போ ஸ்லைட் ஷோ ஏதிலே இருக்கு 1 மினிட் இப்போ விசிபிளா இருக்கா சார்
ஆ மேனேஜிங் தி இட்சி ஸ்கின் இன் தி கிளினிக்
எஸ் சார்
எஸ் சார் எஸ் சார்
Go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. So today's topic will be on managing an itchy skin in the clinic. So managing an itchy skin is a challenge for any practitioner, be it a general practitioner, a primary level physician, or a specialist, or a dermatologist, or even a super specialist. So it presents a unique dilemma. So before going on to the management part, I would like to highlight to you just a few aspects regarding the pruritus and common causes which we encounter regarding pruritus. What is basically pruritus? It is an unpleasant sensation leading to the desire to itch. Usually lasts for around 6 weeks, and it's commonly a symptom of dermatological, systemic, neurological, or a psychiatric disease. So the International Forum for Study of Itch Classification, they have grouped it into three. Group one is basically pruritus on diseased or inflamed skin, pruritus on non-diseased skin, and group three is pruritus presenting with severe chronic secondary lesions like prurigo nodularis. So what are all the common diseases that induce pruritus? So we can classify them basically into the dermatological conditions, what we commonly encounter in the dermatological outpatient department. So the commonest is atopic eczema. So come winter and again come hot summer, we usually have a class of patients who immediately present with severe itching, burning, along with some respiratory symptoms. Most of them may turn out to be cases of our atopic eczema. Contrary to the Western literature where they document more during winter, in summer also in tropical climate we get it in India. The other common condition is urticaria, which presents as peels and again dermographism. Erythroderma or exfoliative dermatitis. Then we have a post-burn scar. Then we have psoriasis, lichen planus, then lichen sclerosis, systemic sclerosis, and cutaneous amyloidosis. So going on to the systemic diseases, we have hepatobiliary diseases, may or may not be associated with cholestasis, chronic kidney disease, anorexia, diabetes mellitus, and hyperthyroidism. Among the infective diseases, we have acquired immune deficiency syndrome, scabies, and chronic dermatophytosis, which is an increasing challenge nowadays because of increased resistance to antifungal therapy. Then next, we go on to the diseases that induce pruritus. Among that, the hematological diseases, we have the Hodgkin's lymphoma, polycythemia vera, iron deficiency anemia. Then the drug-induced entities causing pruritus are commonly due to the biological rituximab, targeted anti-cancer therapies, imatinib, infliximab, hydroxyethyl star, etc. Neurological condition, we have our brachioradial pruritus, notalgia paresthetica, post-herpetic neuralgia. There is no age limit for the development of pruritus. It can develop starting from a very younger age in the patient, from an infant, again, advancing age, middle age also, it can be present. And there is no sexual predilection. It can occur in men as well as women. Ethnicity, they have encountered most commonly in the Western hemisphere, it is very common. Whereas in the Indian context, many a time it goes underreported unless the patient is unable to withstand or bear the amount of itching. The pathophysiology of pruritus, basically, itching is transmitted through unmyelinated mechanocyte fibers and unmyelinated A delta fibers, C fibers, and delta fibers. So this is just the pathway for your understanding. So it can present in several ways. It can commonly present as scratching. This usually reflects functioning at the spinal level, modified greatly by the centers, allokinesis, which is a normally innocuous stimulus which induces itching, and hyperkinesis, where an enhanced itching stimulation is elicited even for a normal stimuli. The common conditions what we encounter are the pruritus of atopic dermatitis. We can make out the erythema over the face in this particular infant, infantile atopic eczema, chronically crying child, irritable child, which will never go to sleep, which may spoil the sleep for the mother also at time. It gets worsened at night. It can get aggravated by contact with any wool, sweating, ingestion of spicy food. Staph aureus, again, in our country as a super antigen, also be dominant. Treatment part, usually emollients, topical steroids, phototherapy, and immunomodulators are used to bring the condition around. And the problem is it can go well into childhood and adulthood and needs to be constantly monitored. And in chronic kidney disease, we have generalized intractable pruritus. So secondary skin changes like your dryness of the skin may again predispose to the itching. Here the mechanism actually is little different here in the uremic pruritus. And it can also cause certain toxic effects on the marrow, which may again trigger the mast cells to produce severe itching. Hepatobiliary disease, as we have already seen, these are the generalized or localized to the hands and feet invariably, and it's often associated with it. So many a patient, especially who are there in the gastroenterology, will be missing them constantly rubbing their hands or folding their hands and rubbing. So this is how the itching manifests in them. Here, of course, the treatment part with cholesterol, UDCA, phenobarbital, carbamazepine, plasmapheresis, etc. It's all been tried out over here. And one important thing is the implication of autoaxin, lipolysis in this particular condition. Polycythemia vera, the characteristic this one presenting as aquagenic pruritus. You have pathogenesis mainly because of platelet aggregation causing serotonin and histamine release on the inflammatory mediators. Treatment aspects, we are using all these here, these conditions. Senile pruritus, as with advancing age, there is always a tendency for dryness. Reduction in the amount of hydration in the skin leading on to, again, dryness of the skin. There is a reduction in sebum production and water holding capacity also is reduced. So, dystrophic changes come there. This can again be exacerbated by diabetes, thyroid disorders and anemia. The other important thing is pruritus in pregnancy. We see it around 20% of pregnant women, which mainly may be due to pre-existing dermatosis. Conditions which manifested even before the pregnancy, like any psoriasis, atopic dermatitis, etc. Then we have the certain changes in the maternal profile where there is certain hormones which cause the dilation of blood vessels to supply to the growing fetus. Now, this itself in turn can produce certain pruritus in the patient. Notalgia paresthesia, this is a very common presentation. You see the postural aspect of the back, mid portion of the back, usually a dark patch will be there, a burning pruritus in the mid scapular movement. And mild lichenification is seen here in this. So, this is the other common condition you encounter is urticaria, intensely itchy condition, lot of veal's erythema will be there, sometimes can present with angioedema, swelling of the lips also. Most commonly, drugs are the common factor. Insect bite, insect sting, taking different kind of foodstuffs also can aggravate this particular condition. Lichen simplex chronicus is another common condition which causes intense pruritus. Lichen planus, pruritic papular patients with purplish appearance, what is a classical distribution. Intensely itchy condition. More so, patients come with diabetes, it is a common form of it. Lichen sclerosis and atrophy, because you can see the lilac color of whale atrophy in the condition. Here also it is intense pruritus, more so when the genital mucosa is affected in the patient. This is the common classical thing. Every dermatologist, every student, medical student has first time they step into the dermatology work, it is one of the first cases we should show them. Itching between the wet spaces with multiple papular lesions showing in scabies. Commonly preventable condition, one of the intensely itchy conditions, and invariably nowadays it spreads throughout the family and can have disastrous consequences. Common other problem is the dermatophyte infection. So, tinea carpor is one of the common problems now, and most of the dermatophytosis have become resistant to the first line of therapy in the patient. So, common clotrimazole or other imidazoles or alilamines, what we have been using, they are no longer effective. So, we need to go for newer agents and prolonged course of therapy. What we were giving the therapy for around 4 weeks, we need to shift it to around 6 to 8 weeks or even 2 months for the condition to come under control. And the other disastrous problem we are having now is lot of proliferation of these mixed preparations being given over the counter. So, invariably, patient messes up their fungal infection, comes to us or comes to the physician, and they want instant gratification, which is no longer possible. So, we have to counsel them before starting the treatment. This is another problem that is unfolding like this. Mastocytosis, common presentation. When we stroke the skin, we will get the erythematous peel, what we call as a barrier sign. It can come in the pediatric age group or adult age group. Prurigo nodularis, it's another condition what we are mentioning, hyperpigmented papular lesions which may seem over the skin. This is the other dermatological condition which requires hospitalization, erythrodermal exfoliative dermatitis, brought on mainly by drugs, persistent eczemas, systemic disorders, malignancies, blood clot. So this is the condition which can present as a dermatological emergency and requires hospitalization or management. Cutaneous amyloidosis is another condition, may or may not be associated with renal, chronic renal disease. Sometimes may present along with certain neurological conditions. Again, light chain disease and other things. Dermatitis is another increasingly chic condition. Sometimes can drive the patient even to suicide. So this is the thing. And the treatment of choice for is prompt identification after histopathology, immediate starting of dapsone, which can be just give a magical cure. Now, going on what all investigations we need to do for the chronic pruritus. So, first step is clinical examination. The next step is screening. So, complete blood count. ESR needs to be done. Liver function test, renal function test. Blood glucose levels need to be monitored. Serum ferritin levels need to be monitored. Stool test for, again, for parasites, helminthic infestations. And again, any strongyloidus allergies. Chest x-rays, again, rule out any systemic involvement. Then ultrasound abdomen to check for any other things. Then biopsy with histopathology. That invariably most of the conditions that may give us a definitive diagnosis as far as the dermatological profile is concerned. Then immune electrophoresis can be done when we're suspecting the pruritus secondary to be any myeloproliferative disorders, again any myelomas. So monoclonal gammopathy is very much helpful. Screening for hepatitis B and C antibodies and hepatitis C more or less nowadays because it is increasingly being found and a lot of drug reactions attributable to hepatitis C also we have seen. HIV antibodies again we have to do. DNA will have to get it done. Parathormone will have to get it done. Calcium levels, PSA, bile acid levels, swab for candida, especially in female patients. And again, intertriginous areas, many dermatoses that we'll have to check out. Urine histamine and metabolites need to be screened. Then again, MRI of the thoracic and cervical spine for neuropathic after the physician or the neurologist case, these things also need to be done. Then, in addition to that, nowadays we should not forget again COVID test has to be done. So many a cases we are getting wherein patient comes either with a febrile state with severe itching or post recovery with the thing we are getting the patients with severe COVID. So these are some of the things we might need to keep in our mind. Going on to the management part, the general measures. Basically, there is an important thing needs to be stressed is the avoidance of the worsening factors. For example, in our summer climate, like for example, the month of April or May in Madras, you have to be very careful. Ask the person to avoid outside exposure to the intense heat and again usage of proper cotton clothing and staying in a well-ventilated room, frequent washing daily. So, to prevent dryness of skin again after washing, some emollient can be applied. Then avoidance of contact with irritant substances can be done. Hot, spicy food can be avoided. Then too much of excitement or sometimes some people tend to isolate themselves, which can again lead on to a negative stress mechanism that also needs to be taken care of. Then the application of a moisturizer after a short lukewarm bath needs to be done. Use of non-alkaline soaps or we have a class of soaps we call as Sindex, which are having a neutral pH that won't do any harm to the skin. That can be done. Soft cotton clothing, especially in our climate, which is permeable to air. Topicals containing antipruritic agent can also be useful. Now, going on to the topical treatment, barrier creams play an important role. So, restoration of the barrier function that plays in the U.S. It again protects the transepidermal water loss in the patient. So, the skin becomes very much dry. This can be prevented. Then, we have minimal fissuring and exposure which can again trigger the C fibers for itching. So fissuring or dryness in the skin can be brought up. Topical salicylic acid, you know, we use whenever the skin becomes a little thickened or lichenified, the cure test can be reduced as a combination of salicylic acid along with topical steroid can be used. Then topical immunomodulators like tacrolimus, microlimus, especially in atopic dermatitis, they are a very important part of a therapeutic armamentarium. They help us to avoid usage of a lot of topical steroids which are prone to a lot of side effects. Then coolants and powder irritants. So menthol basically cools the skin via the TRP channels on the cutaneous nerve endings, and immediate relief from the itching and burning will be there. Then we have capsaicin. Basically, it is an active compound found in chili. It helps to prevent the release of substance B, the C nerve fibers and substantia gelatins. It is very much useful in neuropathic itch, uremic itch, atopic dermatitis, and also in post-herpetic neuralgia and again notalgia. So these conditions where the triggering of the fibers play a differential role in the expression of the pain and the itching is very much helpful. Then topical anesthetics. So topical anesthetics like pramoxin, they block the transmission of nerve impulses used in facial eczema or atopic dermatitis. It is very much useful. Then again, it can again be mixed with topical emollients or even topical steroid preparations to reduce the amount of burning or stinging irritation. So only problem, we have to use it with little caution in some patients who are having the sensitization reactions. Polydoconal, 10-25% urea and 3% polydoconal, is also used along with the topical steroids in psoriasis, atopic dermatitis, and again in uremic patients. Topical antihistaminics like doxepin cream, 5% cream, potent inhibition of your H1 and H2 is very much useful here. It has been used as a combination with emollients and again other lotions also. Topical cannabinoids are also useful in atopic dermatitis and uremic pruritus. Now going on to the systemic antipruritic effect. So whenever the patient presents to us immediate severe itching, the important thing is to bring down two factors. One, the itching, then the anxiety associated with itching. Both these are basically meant by the usage of sedative antihistamine. So they play an important role in controlling the itching. So histamine mediated H1 receptors are generally blocked by H1 antihistamines. So the first generation, we still prefer sedative and anticholinergic action. Among that, hydroxyzine tetrachloride 25 to 50 milligram is available even in injectable form and is very much useful. Then the second generation H1, which are suitable for day-to-day use. So the previous one we were using cetirizine, levocetirizine. Nowadays, loratadine, desloratadine, dextrofenadine, and even bilastine is now being used. They get a lot of efficacy with bilastine nowadays. Then antidepressants. Whenever neurological components or a psychological component or a psychodermatosis is going to manifest, we need an antidepressant. For example, doxycycline can be used 25 to 100 milligrams per day. This is for chronic urticaria, lichen-sensitive spondylitis, and sometimes even in late phase uremic temperatures. Mitrazoine, again 7.5 to 15 milligrams, that is also useful. Then opiate antagonist and agonist. See, basically what happens, most of the cases, we are having treatment which is directed against the H1 or H2 receptor. Whereas in systemic disorders, wherever itching is there, we require some drugs which act centrally. So we have opioid receptors in the body which are being acted upon by these drugs. So naloxone and naltrexone, they act basically on the mu opioid receptors. So they're very much useful in cholestatic and uremic pruritus. Then nalfurin, which is a kappa antagonist, agonist, it is effective in uremic pruritus. Buprofenol, which is a kappa agonist and a mu antagonist, intractable pruritus due to systemic disorders and again malignancies also, it is very much useful. Then neuroleptics like gabapentin, 300 milligram, usually we give around 300, the dosage what our Harrison and all recommends, 300 milligram PID. Unfortunately, our patients and all don't tolerate more than 600 milligram per day. So that you will have to get and give. And depending on the body constitution, it can be given up to 3600 milligrams. Then pregabalin, 75 to 300 milligrams will also be used. Then thalidomide. See, thalidomide is one of the drugs historically in all the pharmacology textbooks mentioned that because of phocomelia it was withdrawn. Now we are seeing the re-emergence of this drug because of its efficacy. It is being used extensively for type 2 lepra reactions. It has been approved by the American FDA for that. In addition, recurrent after stomatitis due to HIV, due to rashes, is very much useful. Then again, as an adjuvant drug along with treatment in myeloma, also it is useful. It acts by inhibition of TNF-alpha. So 100 milligram QD, it is used in multiple myeloma, lymphoproliferative disorders as an adjuvant treatment. Then substance P antagonist. So we must have all, I think most of the super specialists, especially the oncologist will be very familiar with this one, aprepitant, 80 milligram it is given for prurigo nodularis we are using. Then again for recalcitrant atopic eczema, and most importantly, pruritus associated with malignancies. So patient, especially the end stage of the disease, or having prolonged treatment sessions, this is a drug which is very much useful. Then phototherapy, where nothing else works and the patient is very sick. As a palliative measure, phototherapy can be narrowband UV is effective for controlling the pruritus, especially in intractable cases of irritable dermatitis, psoriasis, chronic kidney disease, also it is useful. And phototherapy decreases the population of mast cells by inducing apoptosis and causing peripheral nerves. So progressively it will depopulate the dendritic cells from the skin. So it will, that way it goes and gets healthy. The only problem with using phototherapy is patients who are usually having lot of any metastasis on the skin, they may not be ideal candidates for this. The other advantage of phototherapy, even in patients with retroviral infection, also you can use this drug, unless there is not going to be any history of the normal medicine cancer. Cutaneous field stimulation and acupuncture. So, when all the in addition to our therapeutic armamentarium, we have these also. So, electrical stimulation of the afferent fibers, it is very much useful here. It targets the unmyelinated C fibers, causing degeneration of the epidermal nerve fiber. It is useful in patients with localized itching, which is generally refractory to other treatment forms. So there it is very much useful. Just like what we use the TENS, transseptal nerve stimulation for pain control. This is another thing that is very much useful. So these are some of the, this one I'd like to run through for the management of this. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Murugan, sir, because your extensive, elaborative lecture on itchy skin. Whenever we get a patient comes with the itchy skin, we always have so many problems. It's also itchy for us, itchy for the doctor. If patient comes with itchy skin, it's itchy for the doctor. Now, open to the floor. Any questions from the audience? Members, you can ask any question if you have any doubt, because itchy skin is itchy for all the doctors.
Sir, can I ask a question, sir?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Murugan, thank you for extensive lecture.
Yes,
sir. Sir, several times post-operative patients, they complain of itchiness.
Yes, sir.
Now, traditionally, we remove the dressing and say it'll get all right.
Okay, sir.
Most of the time, it gets all right, but sometimes it persists.
Okay.
We don't know the reason. There is no fever, there is no blip, there is nothing. What do you think could be the cause?
See, sir, there are two things. One, after any surgery or any procedure in the skin, basically, there's a dermal disruption. Whenever the recovery occurs in that particular area, there, as part of the recovery, somehow there is a little bit of overlap between the nerve supply in some of the areas. So that can be one of the triggers in that area. Then another thing what we are commonly now observing is large incidence of contact dermatitis is coming up, sir. People are usually post-operatively, because a very good post-operative care area might be again treated with a lot of betadine and other this one. So that is one another thing. So there is frequent rubbing of that area. Perception of pain might again show up as itching. So this is a very like kind of a gray area where the perception can change. The pain can also not show up as itching in some of the cases. Like you have in diabetes, peripheral neuropathy can also present as itching. So we need to be very kind of guarded in our response whenever we are treating such patients.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah, and if any too much, this one, is there some any anxiolytic or neuroleptic can be given, sir? Or it can be, or localized hypothermia or numbing also is very good.
Just local application of local anesthetic like lignocaine help?
Yes, sir. Short term, it can help, sir. Short term,
we can tell. Sir, another question from me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, because the tinea cruris and tinea infection is a long-standing problem, sir.
Yes, sir. Nowadays,
because of the tinea cruris.
Yes, sir.
Whatever we give, like starting with the clotrimazole, itraconazole, then all the luliconazole, all the zoles.
Yes, sir.
Still is not being controlled, sir. What is your
advice? Sir, the problem what happens, sir, now lot of over-the-counter preparations are available. Like in our IADVL forum, there was a talk as to why there is a sudden surge in the infections. See, what has happened, sir, the government has brought mixed preparations under drug control. So, a combination of steroid with antifungal, with the antibiotic and all is priced at around 8 or 7 rupees. Whereas the any cheapest antifungal is priced at close to around 20 or 30 rupees. So when the patient goes most of the time over the counter, the pharmacist dispenses these preparations. And by the time they come to us, the lesion is very much extensive. And again, in addition to that, if you see, you won't respond to the initial line of treatment or our first line treatment like any clotrimazole or anything. We need to have at least 3 to 4 courses of antifungals. So previously, what we are observing now, fluconazole, we are not having much success in this. Even double the dose or triple the dose, it is not working. Chrysoprolol, at least we have to give it close for around 3.5 to 4 months. Even itraconazole, we are giving around close to around 3 months or even 4 months for the thing to come. Certain again, the patient also loses patience in taking the treatment for more than 3 or 4 weeks. So that is another problem for the patients. So ideally, it is better to go in for the newer antifungal, sir. Any allylamines or azoles, the newer ones are always better.
Sir, when you take a newer antibiotic, the resistance comes easily, sir, because the patient does not respond to the newer antifungal. Then you have to go for the old and good old antifungal, sir. What is your opinion?
Sir, what is happening nowadays? Like, for example, if you are prescribing itraconazole, we prescribe itraconazole. Previously, the textbook generally we see mentions around itraconazole 200 milligram once a day to be taken for close to a month, 4 weeks for the treatment to be completed. Nowadays, it is like a quarter way treatment only. For example, only 1/3 of the treatment is 200 milligram. We are ending up giving twice that dose probably for 2 months or 3 months on a trot. And it is a costly medication. So patients tend to drop out after, say, 2 or 3 weeks when they don't see much improvement. That is the main problem, sir.
Sir, can aloe vera can treat the tinea infection, sir?
No, sir. Definitely not. Aloe vera is a problematic thing. If you use it on the irritated skin, it will cause sensitization reaction, sir. You can use it for dry skin. And again, after bath, for good hydration, it can be used, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank
There's a question in the chat box, sir. Do glycerin-based soaps worsen eczema?
Sir, glycerin-based soaps have been used as part of treatment, especially for dry skin, atopic eczema and other things. The problem is, whenever lanolin is added or certain perfuming agents for some flavor are added to that, they can cause problems. So these have to be avoided in the skin. And now that is why there is a proliferation of newer neutral soaps or syndet based soaps, which give very good relief from dry skin. At the same time, they don't sensitize. So that is the big advantage.
Sir, how about applying antihistamine lotions?
Sir, we can use them. Nowadays, there are a good amount of antihistaminic lotions on the skin. And these can be used when the dermatitis area is very large and the patient is continuously using as a steroid holiday or as a sequential therapy along with the topical steroids, we can use that. Or you can even mix it with that and apply, sir. Especially senior citizens and them, we can use it. Only thing, it should be on unbroken skin. If it is used on any broken skin or anything, the propylene glycol, which is a part and parcel of that, can produce the irritation, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you,
sir. Thank you. Thank you.